I have with me, well, the man who had our, and he will be taking your call, Dr. Umar Johnson. Dr. Johnson is a psychologist and Pan-Africanist. He wrote the book, Psycho-Academic Holocaust. The Special Education and ADHD War Against Black Boys. Very interesting. I wanted to talk to him about these and other issues. Dr. Johnson, welcome to the show, sir.
Good morning. The Honest Mind, thanks for having me.
I appreciate you being here, buddy. The first thing I'd like to ask you, just take about 10 seconds or so, what is a Pan-Africanist?
Pan-Africanist is someone who believes that all African people, irrespective of culture, language, religion, class, or nationality, are members of one human family, and that they should primarily identify themselves as members of that human family before they identify themselves as members of any other group, religious, secular, or otherwise. So we believe that being African is more important and should take precedence over being Christian, Muslim, a Greek, a Mason, or anything else. And the second tenet of Pan-Africanism is that we have an international responsibility to work together in order to collectively improve the conditions under which African people live. Pan-Africanism posits that we can't really rise as separate groups. We have to rise as one because our conditions are so intimately linked in with one another that you can't possibly realize success on the regional or national level without working with the whole international African family.
Amazing. And so does that include white people, too, who are born and raised in Africa?
Okay. No. Pan-Africanism believes in self-reliance. And so when we talk about Pan-Africanism, we're talking about a self-reliant movement of African people solving their own problems, which is no different than what other groups within the human family do. European Jews primarily work with European Jews. Arabs work with Arabs. East Indians primarily work amongst themselves. So if we look at the way in which most cultures operate, they operate with a degree of exclusivity. And as African people, we reserve the right to also be exclusive.
So are you saying that color first, then religion, nationality, and then the rest?
Not color, because color is a superficial characteristic. Color is nothing more than a symbol of culture and history and biological connectivity. So we would say African family first. Not all Africans have an obvious African look. Most of us do. You can generally tell who is and is not a direct descendant of the original inhabitants of Nile Valley culture. But not all of us look obviously or phenotypically African. We have Africans who can look European and look like other races because we are the mothers and fathers of all other people. It's not uncommon to see some of us look like other people. But yes, most of us are phenotypically African, but not all of us. So it is the DNA that makes us African.
So it's African first and then the rest. But let me ask, in this doesn't include Black Americans who were born in this country. We're not a part of that stuff, right? Because we are Americans. But how?
No, sir.
But how is that?
No,
I mean, for an example, I was born in America, down in Alabama, and I'm 100% American. So I wouldn't be a part of this African stuff, right?
No, that's totally incorrect. Pan-Africanism as a philosophy was actually born in the Western Hemisphere. Pan-Africanism came from the Americas. It came from the Caribbean and went to Africa. So believe it or not, ironically, it was created by quote-unquote American Africans. And so when we talk about Pan-Africanism, as I said earlier, in the definition, it includes all African people, wherever we may live. That's the entire purpose of the philosophy, is to make African people understand that regardless of where you may be, you're still African. There's European Jews all over the planet. but they're still European Jews.
But I'm not African, though. I don't feel like an African. I don't think like an African. I don't look like an African.
Well, that's because of post-traumatic slavery
disorder. I am 100%. I am 100% American.
If you choose to identify politically as an American,
not politically, I am an American.
Okay, well, allow me to make my statement. If you choose to psychologically and politically identify as an American, then so be it. But genetically and biologically, you may be African.
No, I'm not.
Biological, well, it's okay to be in denial. Most Africans are. You have to understand, we suffer from a collective psychosis.
Is this
like that you might be suffering from that yourself.
Is this like that stuff that Louis Farrakhan and Jeremiah Wright Jr. Obama's preaching, talk about this black liberation? Let me just ask, this black liberation stuff, that's what this is all about?
Well, let me clarify. I respect Minister Farrakhan and Reverend Wright, but I'm not followers of either.
Uh-huh.
I think they've done some good things, but neither of them are Pan-African. And I think to get the most accurate representation of what they stand for, you would probably need to speak with one of Minister Farrakhan's ministers. He has several who are more than capable of answering those questions. I wouldn't want to speak for what he actually stands for. I'm a Pan-Africanist. He's not. So, although we both fight for the liberation of black people, we have two different ideologies.
So then, what would you say about this thing that's happening in America? You have black Africans coming here into this great nation, and they are doing very well. They're getting educated. They're starting their own businesses. They have strong families. And the blacks who live here, because they have been wimping and whining and begging for so long, relying on the government and have their children out of wedlock and looking to the so-called black leadership to do and think for them, they are jealous of those black people who are coming here and becoming more independent. So they're not getting along at all. What would you say about that situation if they're all one?
First, I would not agree with your assessment. First off, I do not think that African-Americans are jealous of our brothers and sisters.
Well, why do they fight with them the way they do with the white folks?
Well, if you look at our history under white supremacy, you will find that there has been the engineering of internal differences amongst African people. You see those internal differences at play.
So the white man is to blame for that, too?
Allow me to finish, if I could. I'll be brief. But you see those internal differences at play every day in Africa, where there are no African Americans present. And you also see those internal differences at play here in America, even when Africans from the continent are not here. We have been engineered to work against each other.
So the white man is making the black Americans fight against the black African. So blacks don't have any sense at all. Are you saying that? Let me take
a
break. I'll let you respond when I come back. 888-775-3773. Back in a moment. Dr. Umar Johnson is with me. He is a psychologist and Pan-Africanist. He wrote the book Psycho-Academic Holocaust and the Special Education in ADHD War Against Black Males. I want to talk to him about that as well and tell you how to get his book. So, Dr. Johnson, are you telling me that black people in America are so dumb that white people can even cause them to be jealous of black Africans who come here and do very well?
I think that what you're failing to recognize is when you control access to opportunity, you can sow the seeds of division and behavior that causes members within a particular group to work against their own best interests, to look out for their own selfish personal advancement. And that's exactly what happens among African people. For example, and I work with Africans from the continent. I'm a Pan-African. I'll be going to Ghana this summer, leading a group trip.
Let me make the statement, please.
Because when you deal with these types of issues, they're not yes, no answers. You have to provide the context. And what I briefly want to say is that when Africans come to America, and I know this because I've been told this by many Africans here, they are told, okay, when they come through customs, when they come through immigration, that they would be better off if they didn't deal with Africans who are already here. They're told this when they go through their orientations that it's best to stay away from us. So many of them are afraid of mixing with African Americans because they understand that the American government does not look favorably upon us. And if you're here on a student visa or a work visa or any type of other temporary placement in America, you can be deported very quickly if they catch you working with Dr. Umar Johnson. So that's one of the reasons for the schisms between us and them. They're not allowed to be around us without being risking deportation.
Amazing. So that is a yes, that the white man influence is so great that he can influence Black Americans to hate Black Africans when they come
Black
here.
Black Americans do not hate Africans.
They are jealous of them, their success.
I do not believe that at all.
They're always saying that these Africans
are jealous of an African.
They're always saying that they say that these African people who come here, the Blacks who come here, think that they are better than we are. So that is jealousy.
Well,
that's the same thing they said about the whites, the Jews, any group that have done well in this country.
Let me say this. Two things you're overlooking. Number one, the Africans who are allowed to come to America are allowed to come here because customs and immigration knows that they're not going to get out of hand. There's a lot of revolutionary Pan-Africanists in Africa who have never been allowed to come to America. I have friends in Senegal, friends in Nigeria, friends in South Africa who've been trying to come to America, not to live, just to visit me. And their visas have constantly been turned down.
But there are a lot of folks who try to come here and can't get here.
Hold on. Let me. The Africans who is allowed to come to America is not the one who's likely to work with African people against white supremacy for our collective betterment.
Well, we don't want troublemakers here.
Well, I don't consider someone fighting for their rights a troublemaker. When the European Jews stood up against the Nazis, they weren't making trouble. They were defending their human rights. And that's exactly what we do when we stand up. Now, if defending our rights, our human rights, makes us troublemakers, then so be it. But the other thing you're missing, is all immigrants who come to America are given preferential treatment over African Americans because we are not wanted here. The other thing you're
missing. Who don't want you here?
All immigrants. Hold on.
No, who don't want you here, sir?
Come to America.
Doctor.
Let me finish this.
No, tell me this first. Who don't want you? Who don't want you here?
I'm listening to you.
No, you're not listening to me. You.
Let me make this.
I ask you a question and you go on and on.
Two second statement, and that is this. All other non-white peoples who come to America are giving access to capital and resources that allows them the opportunity to build up business and commerce. And the same banks that give them that opportunity practice financial racism against Black people,
amazing,
which prevent us from having an opportunity to build up economic infrastructure. Racism is at the root of all of the ills that we suffer, Jesse.
Okay.
We do not control the miseducation system.
We
do not control the economy.
Doctor, hold on.
Stop blaming the victim.
You said a lot.
I need you, my brother.
Hold on.
Stop blaming the victim, and I need you to start loving your people. And I want you to be an argument for your people and not for their oppressors.
Doctor, you're saying a lot here. First, are you comparing white Americans to the Nazis?
We could.
And that's what you're doing? Are you doing that?
We could. Yes. Yes, we very well could because the
I said, are you doing that?
Yes, because the extermination campaign, the extermination campaign against African men in America is no different than the Nazi extermination campaign of European Jews. They are identical. What is being done to Black men now You have concentration camps in America right now called prisons. 95% of black people in those prisons are not there because they committed a crime. They're there because they cannot afford adequate, decent representation.
Well, why do they need? Why do they need representation? Why did they? Hold on, hey, hold on.
Represented on death row.
Why did they need representation? Did they do anything that required?
Because they've been charged.
Okay, so they did something that required them to need it.
False crime.
Hold on, I want to go back to something else you said.
Was being black.
Dr. Johnson, hold on a minute.
The crime they committed was being black, my brother.
Okay, calm down.
No, I'm calm. I'm very calm.
No, calm down.
Very calm.
That's dialogue.
But
you
I'm
said
orator,
that the government...
So when we're on the telephone, it may appear that I'm not calm, but I'm quite calm. I'm laying in my hotel bed, as a matter of fact, talking to you.
Okay, let me ask. You said that the government doesn't... First, let me ask, who doesn't... want you here? You said they don't want us here. Who doesn't want you here?
The American social order, which includes the government as well as sympathizing whites, which includes the majority of them. And you don't have to take my opinion for it. There's been polls done for the past 50 years that clearly show that most white people would desire an America without black people. Are you telling me you don't know that? Is that not why we have segregation?
I'm not aware of that. I'm not aware of that.
Is that not why we have segregation?
Let me ask you this.
Is that not why most white people prefer to live with white folks? Is that not why most white people would prefer that their kids go to an all-white school? Are you telling me you don't understand white supremacy? I'm sure you're an intelligent black man. Please don't tell me you don't understand white supremacy exists in this country.
May I tell you, let me tell you why most white Americans and good black folks don't want to live with other black people, because they don't want to live in ghettos. They don't want to live in crime-ridden areas. They don't want to go to school. Let me finish. Yeah, I'll let you ask, but hold on. They don't want to go to school, to schools in the urban area where your children's lives are at risk, or they are called white if they try to do well in school. Why would anybody with any common sense want to live in those types of environments?
Okay. Well, first of all, I have to say this. With all respect, you are a sad case, my brother.
What did I do?
I mean, you totally identify with the enemies of your people. You have no compassion.
What did I do?
For your people. You are the reason that I became a psychologist, to help self-hating black people overcome their trauma. I mean, to hear you talk, it's a shame that we have black men like you who should be fighting for their people.
I am fighting for my people.
Protecting their integrity.
Hold on, Dr. Johnson. Let me take a break. 888-775-3773. We're going to get to your calls after this break.
Oh, 8583.
As a young man, when I realized that pain leads to gain in physical health, I decided that I'd exercise in some form for life. It took me a bit longer to realize that emotional and spiritual pain also have a value. At one time, I wished that I could avoid society, but thanks to the counseling of Reverend Jesse Lee Peterson, I now understand that emotional and spiritual pain are exactly what I need to grow. No, I don't go looking for trouble, but by being my true self, it finds me. Those people and situations I once feared and dreaded are the very stuff from which I now grow, thanks to Jesse Lee Peterson's counseling and spiritual guidance. For your sake and sanity, get it for yourself by calling 800-411-BOND. That's 800-411-2663.
Okay, folks, welcome back. It is Manhood Hour every Wednesday, last hour of the month, of the week, of the day, rebuilding the family by rebuilding the man. I've spent the last 24 years rebuilding the family by rebuilding the man. I do love black people. I love black people. And I'm talking with Dr. Umar Johnson. He is a psychologist and Pan-Africanist. We're going to tell you how to get his book, how to get to his website, and all that good stuff in a minute. And the board is smoking here, so we are going to get to all of your calls. But, Doctor, before we go to the calls, I need to know three things that you said. Just kind of clarify for me. You said that we talked about how you said that white people don't go to the same school with blacks. They want to move away from the community, black communities and things like that. And I said, black people are doing it too. People like Jay-Z, you heard of Jay-Z, right? And Beyonce,
Yes, sir.
And Beyonce, you heard of her, right?
Yes,
Beyonce.
We are proud of a black bourgeoisie. We do have a black bourgeoisie.
And you heard.
Let me
just finish. You heard of Barack Obama and Michelle Obama, right?
Yes, I have.
They moved out. You heard of Oprah.
Mm-hmm.
And she moved out. Are those black people racist against white folks? Are those black people racist against black people as well for moving out of those ghettos?
Okay. Well, first of all, the people that you named represent an extremely small minority amongst the larger population of African-Americans.
Are they racist against blacks?
Hold on. I'm going to answer the question. But it's important when we have conversations like this that we don't look for exceptions to the rule. We have to look at the conditions of the everyday black person. And the average black person isn't able to afford a lifestyle.
That's not what I'm asking you. You're wasting my time here.
Now, are they
racist against blacks?
Black people cannot be racist. They can only be victims or agents of racism, but they cannot be racist.
So these black successful folks who move out, these black successful folks who move out and don't let their children go to the inner city schools are not racist, but white people who move out of the ghettos are racist.
Yes.
In your opinion.
In order to be a racist, you must belong to a group that has the power to exercise oppression against the other. Although Jay-Z and Oprah
Obama,
may be rich, they do not belong.
Obama is the president. He has the power to.
He is the president.
Does he have the power to present racism toward others?
Does he have the power to present racism towards others? President Obama is not a white male. And because he's not a white male, he cannot be racist. He can only be an agent of the racism.
Oh,
President
Jesus.
Obama is an agent of racism.
Even Louis Farrakhan and what's that other racist guy name? The preacher? Jeremiah Wright Jr. moved onto a golf course and got a fence around his home to keep away from the blacks. Is he racist?
Really? Well, I haven't heard you mention Rush Limbaugh.
What about
it? Identified a racist, and I haven't heard you mention Billy Graham, who was also a racist.
No, you accuse white people moving out of the black communities because they were racist, and I say you're wrong about that. And I name all these black people.
Do you know your history?
I name these black people who move out. Even Snoop Dogg moved out.
No.
And you said they can't be a racist. So, either you don't know what you're talking about, or you've been deceived.
Do you know how ghettos were created? Ghettos were created between World War I and World War II. When black people came up during the Great Migration, white people fled the inner cities where they used to dominate and ran to the suburbs because they didn't want to live around black
people. Do you live in the inner city?
Then the federal.
Do you live in the inner cities?
Yes, I do.
Let me ask you this, then. We have heard that crap. We heard that.
No, Daisy, because you keep on oppressing the truth. Don't oppress the truth, my brother. If I'm allowing you to express yourself, and I don't have a problem.
I know, but make you a short because you're going on too long. We're going to get some calls.
I'm not going on long. It's only because I'm disagreeing with you and you want to dominate the conversation.
No, you're taking too long.
Let me make this statement. The Federal Housing Association, along with the American Social Order, which includes the government and white people, created ghettos through the Federal Housing Association by giving white people low-interest loans, which allowed poor white people to move to the suburbs, and then they denied the same low-interest loans to black people living in the ghettos,
and
thereby
so,
trapping us in the ghetto and allowing white people to escape. You need to study your history on how ghettos were created.
Let me ask you this.
Jewish word.
Let me say
it
this.
It's a Jewish word.
Okay, I heard all that.
It's a Jewish word.
Let me ask
first
this.
Referred to the poor white Jews who once dominated in America's city, but were given white privilege. Okay, white affirmative
action hold on.
In the form of low-interest loans by the Federal Housing Association.
Doctor, hold on. Let me
Don't
ask this.
Don't mislead your listeners.
I know, but stay with
Don't
me.
Don't mislead
stay
your
with
listeners.
Me. Stay with
Tell
me. Let me ask you this.
Truth.
Let me ask.
Tell
so let's say that social engineering did happen or is happening or did happen.
Is happening.
Once they put black people in those areas, what prevent black people from keeping those areas clean,
beautiful,
safe?
Question.
Why do they kill each other? Why don't
beautiful question.
Is it that the white man is causing them to live an immoral lifestyle as well?
Okay. Well, it's interesting you put morals in the equation, because if you look at white America, including suburban white America, if you want to evaluate people's morals, they're no more moralistic than
But you're not
else.
Answering my question.
I mean, how immoral.
Are the white people causing black people to live listen.
From realizing a decent quality of life so that you can do such? Racism is inherently immoral. But to answer your question, why ghettos remain ghettos is because black people are denied systematically, as I said earlier, access to capital. That would allow them.
Who caused black?
We are denied access to wealth. We are denied access to community
credit. Let me ask
that
this.
Would allow us to build up our community. That's why ghettos stay ghettos. In fact, my brother.
So the white man is to blame. Why are black people so dumb that they let white people control them
this?
Like this?
Who controls the economic system in America? Black people.
Obama.
Or white people.
Obama at this
Obama
point.
Obama doesn't control anything. Obama is an employee.
The NAACP, Jesse Jackson, Louis Farrakhan, and all
Obama
those
Obama is an in, simply the face on white supremacy.
So why?
It's not a force behind
So why did you people want a black president if he wasn't going to be of any good
beautiful
to you?
Beautiful question, my brother. Beautiful question, my brother. And my answer is real simple. Because black people are just as politically uneducated and ignorant about how America really functions as are white people.
So we should black not have given you a black president? We should not have given you a black president?
It was irrelevant. We already had black presidents. We already had them.
Who?
Abraham Lincoln, Thomas Jefferson, George Washington, Calvin Coolidge, all these men were violations.
Let me take a quick break. We're coming straight back to the phone. Right after this break, folks, we're going to go directly to the phone. Dr. Johnson is with me back in a moment. Dr. Umar Johnson is with me, and we're going to tell you how to get to his website here in a minute, but I want to get in some calls here. Let's go out to Los Angeles, California first and talk to the Baba Go-To Guy. Baba Go-To Guy, good morning, sir. You're on with Dr. Johnson.
Good morning, Jesse.
Good morning.
That last comment about George Washington and Thomas Jefferson.
You're not going to say good morning to Dr. Johnson?
Oh, I'm sorry. Good morning, Dr. Johnson. But we're not supposed to say that because we're blue-eyed devils. We're not supposed to do that. Anyway, doctor, that was mind-boggling. So now George Washington was the first black president. Is that what I'm hearing?
Well, first let me say that I never referred to white people as blue-eyed devils. Second, let me say that I think it would be in your best interest to read a book called The Five Negro Presidents. That talks about the biracial heritage of five of America's leading presidents. Many of them were African.
So what are we arguing about here then? If we're all black, what are we arguing about?
If you have black presidents already, why are you mad at the white folks?
Yes,
well, number one,
black. There is no white.
Number one, why are we equating a black president with black progress? Why is that being equated?
Having well, if you can equate a white man to black a black president, we can do that too, I guess.
Wait, say that one more time. I didn't hear that.
If you can equate a white man to being a black president, I guess we can do any kind of logic now.
Well, let's be honest. A lot of white people in America, you know, have some very strong African ancestry within their tree they don't like to talk about.
Well, that's right, my brother. So then there is no white people around. We're all black.
No, not true. Not true. Not true.
So what's the point?
Not true. Because there's direct descendants of Africa and there's indirect descendants
of Africa. As white as you can get. Now, if George Washington was black, as you say, then I don't know what we're arguing about here.
Well, he was a biracial ancestry. But being biracial does not eliminate the race issue because most white people desire a pure white race. I mean, the basis of white supremacy is white genetic survival. Most white people do not desire to mix with black. And that's one of the biggest reasons you have such oppressive strategies being engineered against African people. Gun violence.
What an imagination. Your imagination, doctor, your imagination due to your anger and racist attitude toward white Americans have gone wild.
I haven't projected any anger during this conversation today, gentlemen.
But your wild imagination implies that your resentment toward white Americans will not allow you to think straight.
Can be backed up with solid facts.
I'm sorry?
Everything that I've stated on your show today can be factually proven using information from mainstream white America.
I mean,
this black doctor based on opinion. It's all based on facts.
This black doctor's racism is rooted in the same ungodly socialism.
So let me ask you a question.
It's all the same.
To the listeners.
They have the same economic
outlook. I have a question for you, sir.
For everybody.
Do you believe America is fair to African Americans? Do you believe that there's not
more than fair? More than fair. It's gone out of their way to be fair.
So how do you explain?
There's been a lot
out of every four. How do you explain one out of every four African American boys graduating from high school?
Because
how do you explain two out of every four African American males being under some form of supervision under the criminal justice?
Hold on, one at a time. Hold on.
Okay.
Go ahead, Baba. Go to God.
Yeah, you asked me the question because blame for anything they do was taken, and you're doing that this morning. Blame for anything they do is taken away from the black man and given to the white man. How are they ever going to get any better? They won't.
Let me explain why it's like that. Due to the destruction of the family.
Hold on, Doc. Let me, Doc.
You asked, how do you explain that? Thank you, Baba. Go to God.
Distortion. And denial.
Doc, let me explain it real fast. Hold on. Hold on, Doc. I haven't said yet. I haven't explained yet. The reason for that, due to the lack of family, the destruction of the family in the black community, due to the lack of more character. Hold on, Doc. Due to the lack of more character, most black people are suffering not because of racism, but the lack of more character. Due to the fact that most black people don't think for themselves, they listen to other racist so-called black leaders, and they're being brainwashed, dumbed down, and demoralized. They rely on the government to take care of them instead of themselves. Let's go out to Nashville and talk to Jarvis. Jarvis, you're on with Dr. Johnson.
May I ask you a question before you go to Jarvis?
Go ahead.
May I ask you a question? Here's my question. During the break, I heard a commercial from you. Listen up. It said, in order to rebuild the family, we have to rebuild the man.
Yes.
I heard you say that.
Yes.
Now, if we have to rebuild the man in order to rebuild the family, how can you claim that the United States government isn't the primary destroyer of the black family when they are the ones locking up all the black men, preventing them from building their families? If the government is locking all the black men up, how in the hell can we rebuild black families?
If the black men or men have fathers and fathers and mothers raising them. If the black males,
what about the,
let
the
me finish.
Government
you asked me a question. Hold on.
The fathers are in jail.
If these young black people have, hold on, Doc.
Locking up all the fathers.
If they have fathers and mothers,
fathers, they're in jail.
Hold on, Doc.
What are you going to do about the incarceration system?
Go ahead, Jarvis. Go ahead.
Hey, let me. I'm gonna give him a little quick summary of who I am. I'm a young black dude. I'm 26 now. I used to be in a gang. I used to run the street. By the grace of God, never been to jail. I lived in the ghetto all my life. Recently, as last year, I worked my way out of the ghetto. Me and my wife and kids. And now I do not live in the ghetto. I work for everything I have now. I'm not on no government assistance. I do for myself. How come them people that you're saying that are victims can't do the same as I did?
Excellent question. Excellent question. One of the first things that I found interesting in your statement is that you referred to African Americans as those people as if you're separate from that group. So right
there,
that
African.
Tells me your degree
speaking,
of consciousness.
I'm not an African. Technically speaking, I'm
well,
not an African.
That's your denial.
No. I'm going to tell you what my...
Hold on, guys. Hold on. Let me take a quick break. I'll let you finish. And when I come back, Dr. Johnson, I want you to give out your website. Back in a moment. Okay, folks, welcome back. I'm laughing at my engineer here and my audio engineer. Tomorrow, Hollywood Update with Gabriel will be here. Also, your emails and Facebook comments tomorrow. So you do not want to miss out on that. All right. Let me email, Facebook, YouTube, and tweets tomorrow. Let me go back. Dr. Johnson, before I go back to the callers, Jarvis and others, what's your website? How can folks get your book?
The website is drumarjohnson.com. That's drumarjohnson.com. They can order the book, Psychoacademic Holocaust, directly from the website. I recommend that all persons working with African-American children or who are interested in helping African-American children read that book. It's the only one ever written by a black male school psychologist that teaches people how to fight back against the special education machine as well as the ADHD and Ritalin machine.
Okay. Jarvis, are you still there?
Yeah.
Okay. So, doctor, how do you respond to Jarvis that he was able to pull himself up? Why can't other black folks do the same?
Well, one of my issues with Jarvis's comment was it was totally based on his own individual experience. One thing that we have to do is stop looking at the world only through the conditions under which we live and the obstacles in our path. We have to look at what is going on with all of our people. What is the general condition? I'm glad that Jarvis was able to do what he did, and I'm very proud of my brother. But it sounds like he was only interested in getting away from his people. As he said, I moved out the ghetto. I want to know why he didn't stay in the ghetto and help the other people in the ghetto move up. In other words,
let me tell you why. Let me tell you why.
Because of time, doctor. Hold on, let me tell you.
Look, I'm going to tell you something right quick, man. Number one, I got shot by another black person. Number two, the crime is so heavy, you can't even go around the corner without somebody breaking into somebody else's house or trying to kill somebody else for no particular reason. I'm not trying to get away
but
from
where
nobody.
Do those circumstances come from, Jarvis?
Hold on. Listen to me. This is what happened.
Real fast, y'all.
You don't stay over there and raise kids in that kind of environment. My great-great-grandma came from communist Cuba, dog. You know what I'm saying? She told me what it's like. You get away from that crap.
His community and improve it.
No,
a real black man would have stayed.
Man, you an idiot. You know what? You an idiot. That's what you are.
That's what a real black man would have
done. All right.
A real black man wouldn't have ran away from his people.
Shut up, idiot.
A real black
I gotta
man
go.
Dr.
Johnson, thank you so much for being with me. So we'll have you
thank
back.
Thank you. Let's do it again sometime.